last topic from the larynx, and that is the laryngotracheobronchial foreign body. There are two types of the bronchial foreign body. One is vegetative and other is non-vegetative. Vegetative foreign bodies, commonly the vegetative foreign bodies are chalia and peanuts. And in the non-vegetative foreign bodies, they are like whistle, needle, metallic pieces, glass pieces. These are all non-vegetative foreign bodies. So there are two types, vegetative and non-vegetative. Okay. The common sites of involvement in the busti. The common sites of involvement in the foreign bodies. One is the larynx, trachea, and the bronchi. There are two bronchi, left and right. Which one is commonly involved in the foreign body? The right bronchus. Commonly, the foreign body enters into the right bronchus. Why? Because it is wider, smaller, and directly in line with the trachea. Whereas the left bronchus is angulated. It is larger, and it is not as wider as the right bronchus. So due to the angulation, the foreign body cannot enter into the left bronchus commonly. But as far as the right bronchus is in line with the trachea, so if there is any foreign body in the trachea, it can slip out into the right bronchus. So commonly, the right bronchus is involved. If we go on the clinical features, if the foreign body is laryngeal, if there is a laryngeal foreign body present in the larynx, and particularly if it is present in the glottic area of the larynx between the two vocal cords, then there may be the severe respiratory obstruction and immediate death. But if it is not present into the glottic area, if it is in the supraglottic area or into the subglottic area, then it may cause the dyspnea, cough, stridor, and hoarseness. But if it is present in the glottic area, it may cause the immediate death. If it is a bronchial foreign body, now the symptoms are different if the foreign body is vegetative, and the symptoms are different if the foreign body is non-vegetative. If the foreign body is vegetative, it may cause the inflammatory reaction of the mucosa, and the symptoms will be of the acute bronchitis. That may be the cough, dyspnea, emphysema, atelectasis, lung abscess, pneumonia. So cough, dyspnea, emphysema, atelectasis, lung abscess, and pneumonia, these are present if the foreign body is vegetative. But if the foreign body is non-vegetative and it causes the complete obstruction of the bronchus, then it may cause the lung collapse because the air cannot go in and cannot come out from lungs. But if it does not completely obstruct the bronchus, then there will be a valve effect that the air can go into the lung but cannot come out from the lungs. Then it will cause the obstructive emphysema. Emphysema means more air into the lungs. So lung collapse when there is the complete obstruction of the bronchus and obstructive emphysema when there is incomplete obstruction of the bronchus by the foreign body. Now, what type of investigations you would like to have if you suspect the foreign body in the bronchus or into the larynx? We'll go for X-ray, neck and chest. Radiolucent foreign bodies, if it is a vegetative foreign body, it is a radiolucent foreign body, may produce the changes on radiology due to the inflammation of the mucosa or due to the obstruction. So there will be the emphysema, pneumonia, lung collapse and bronchitic changes may be seen. But if the foreign body is non-vegetative, then again there will be the lung collapse or there will be the obstructive emphysema on the X-ray. So again the same, just like that if it is a vegetative foreign body, there may be the emphysema on X-ray, there may be atelectasis on X-ray, there may be lung abscess on X-ray, there may be the pneumonic patch on X-ray. If it is a non-vegetative, there may be the lung collapse or the obstructive emphysema on the X-ray. What will be the treatment if there is a foreign body in the bronchus? The treatment will be divided into the emergency treatment and into the particular treatment. If there is an emergency, there is respiratory obstruction, then the first emergency maneuver is the Hamlisch maneuver. What is the Hamlisch maneuver? This is the Hamlisch maneuver. This patient has got the foreign body into the larynx. There is complete respiratory obstruction. There is an emergency. The doctor will go back and will wrap both the arms around his chest and will push the area of the symphysis sternum. So when the doctor will push the symphysis sternum, the air into the lungs, which is present into the lungs, the air which is present into the lungs will go up into the trachea and into the larynx and will dislodge the foreign body from the glottic area to some other area so that the acute respiratory obstruction is relieved. So this is called the Hamlisch maneuver, which is an emergency maneuver. If the patient is very small child and there is an emergency and there is a respiratory obstruction, then you will hold, the doctor will hold the smaller child upside down and will slap on back. And when the child is upside down and the doctor will slap on back, this foreign body may dislodge from the glottic area to some other area and it will cause the relievement of the acute respiratory obstruction. The third most important emergency treatment is to do the tracheostomy. If you have got the time for about 7 to 10 minutes, then in emergency you can go for the tracheostomy, make a hole into the trachea and put the tracheostomy tube inside so that the respiratory obstruction should be relieved as soon as possible. So three procedures are emergency procedures. One is the Hamlisch maneuver in adults, slap on back in children, and tracheostomy if you have got the time to relieve the obstruction. Now the definite treatment is that if the foreign body is into the larynx, we will go for direct laryngoscopy. You will see the larynx, you will see the glottic area, and you will locate the foreign body and you will remove the foreign body with the forceps. If it is present into the bronchus, then we'll go for the rigid bronchoscopy. This is very important that we'll go for rigid bronchoscopy. Bronchoscopy is of two types. One is flexible bronchoscopy and other is the rigid bronchoscopy. Flexible bronchoscopy is only for the diagnostic purpose. But for the treatment and particularly for the removal of the foreign body, we will go for the rigid bronchoscopy. We will put the bronchoscope in the bronchus on both the sides, on the left side, on the right side. See the bronchus, locate the foreign body, and remove the foreign body with the forceps. So direct laryngoscopy and removal of the foreign body, and rigid bronchoscopy and removal of the foreign body are the treatment of options in cases when the foreign body are lodged into the larynx or into the bronchus. Now this is a bronchoscope. This is a tube which goes into the trachea, into the larynx, into the trachea, and into the bronchus. This is the light which emits from the end, and this is an eyepiece, right? This is a light source, and this is for the general anesthesia tube which is attached to the bronchus so that the air should go in. This is the whole bronchoscope. Now, as I told you that the bronchoscopy is flexible as well as rigid. But in ENT, the flexible bronchoscopy is used for diagnostic purpose and the rigid bronchoscopy is used for the diagnostic purpose. So indications of bronchoscopy are either therapeutic, either diagnostic. So for the therapeutic purpose, we can go for removal of the foreign body from the trachea and bronchus. It is a main indication. And for diagnostic purpose, rigid bronchoscope can be used, but it is rarely performed now. And we used to perform the flexible fiber optic bronchoscope. Now, this is the procedure of the bronchoscopy. Patient anesthesia, which is used for the bronchoscopy, is the general anesthesia always. The position of the patient will lie on the table as this patient is lying. It is lying on the table and it is in the supine position. You can see that he is in the supine position. And there is flexion at the cervical vertebra and extension of the head at the atlanto-occipital joint. This is the atlanto-occipital joint and it is extended. The sandbag is present under the shoulders So there will be the extension at the atlanto-occipital joint, and there will be the flexion at the neck. So by this position, if you will enter this bronchoscope inside, the trachea and the bronchus, they are in one line. So you can enter from the larynx into the trachea easily, and from the trachea into both of the bronchi very easily, because they are in line by this position. Now this bronchoscope is held in the right side, right hand, always, as this doctor is holding this bronchoscope into the right hand. And it is introduced through the mouth into the larynx. Now this is the bronchoscope, and it is passing from the mouth into the larynx. Now this is the picture which you see when you reach at the larynx, that you can see these both the vocal cords, and you can see the rings of the trachea. So when you will enter into the trachea, and you can locate both of the bronchi very easily. So first step is to see the larynx, and then through the larynx, in between the both the vocal cords, you will enter into the trachea. Slide forward the bronchoscope, you will see this picture. There is a septum in between. On the right side, there is the right bronchus. On the left side, there is the left bronchus. You will have to examine both the bronchi, the right bronchus as well as the left bronchus. So you can enter very easily into the right bronchus first, because the foreign body is common into the right bronchus. So you will enter into the right bronchus first. You will see the foreign body just like this. This is the foreign body present over there. And then you will grasp the foreign body with the forceps, and you will get this foreign body out through the tube of the bronchoscope. After removing the foreign body, you will enter into the left bronchus, and you will see the left bronchus. You will examine the left bronchus. Sometimes it happens that the double foreign bodies are present into the bronchus as well as in the right bronchus, or into the left bronchus, are in both the bronchi. So it is very important that you should examine both the bronchi. Now, what could be the post-operative care when you do the bronchoscopy? Very simple. As far as the patient has gone under general anesthesia, so we will keep the patient nothing but oral for 4 to 6 hours. It is very important that in the post-operative care, the patient is kept in the left lateral position to prevent the aspiration of the blood or secretions into the bronchus again. So you will keep the patient into the left lateral position. Patient should always be observed very closely for any respiratory distress, for any stridor, cyanosis, or any blood stain, sputum. This is very, very important. But what could be the complications of this procedure? Apart from the anesthetic complications, we are not concerned with the anesthetic complications. We go for the surgical complications. And apart from the anesthetic complications, the surgical complications are, first you enter the bronchoscope into the mouth. So there may be the injury to the structures in the mouth. You can injure the teeth, then the pharynx. Then you will enter into the larynx. You can injure the larynx. You can injure the vocal cords. Then you may cause, if there is an injury into the larynx, then there will be the laryngeal edema. If there is laryngeal edema, then the air cannot go in and will cause the hypoxia during the procedure. There may be the bleeding if there is any trauma, or the most important is that there may be the laryngeal spasm. If the larynx is very, very sensitive, then if you push the bronchoscope into the larynx, it will cause 11 gill spasm.